Hello and welcome to our presentation on One Exploit Rule Them All on the security of drop-in replacement and counterfeit microcontrollers. My name is Johannes and I did this research together with Mark and Cosmo. Today we will first show you the scope of our research and then we will present you the chips that we have analyzed. Then I will shortly explain the security concept that we are trying to investigate, and then we will come to the main part of today's presentation, and that are the debug-based attack vectors and the hardware-based attack vectors. Finally, I will give you a conclusion and our outlook on this topic. So, here you see the STM32F1, or what I thought is STM32F1, because after testing around with this device a little bit, I quickly realized it does behave a little bit strangely sometimes. So I concluded this is a fake device, and I played a little bit around with lighting and image enhancements, and I was able to make this CKS marking here visible that rather belongs to a CKS32F1, which is a cheap drop-in replacement for the STM32F1 chip. So this one here has been relabeled. There have been a lot of discussions where all these chips come from, and perhaps there has been a manufacturing leak, there are surplus devices, devices that did not pass testing, or something like that. We will answer that question today. But however, what is also unknown is, how is the security implemented in those devices? So do they share the same vulnerabilities, and is there one exploit to rule them all? So however, we will only focus on do-it-yourself attacks today, since this is something that you can do at home and it is a very realistic attacker model here. So that is the original device here. For our research we selected 5 more devices that are often marketed as drop-in replacements. That's the APM32, the CKS32 and 3 GD32 devices. The last GD32 device you see here, it does not contain a Cortex-M3 core like the other devices, but it contains the newer RISC-V core. However, it contains the same peripherals like the original device so far, so they are all quite comparable. The first question we have here is, do the chips contain the same die in the package, or are they different? To answer this question, I did some destructive decapping. I put the chips on the hot plate and poured some sulfuric acid on them. This etched away the package and I gained access to the internal die of each device. You can see the pictures of the dies on the right hand side of the slide. These pictures are roughly to scale, so you immediately notice that the sizes of the dies are very dissimilar to each other. Also, when you take a look at the structure of the dies, you can see that they are not really similar when we are comparing them to each other. Based on this very simple analysis, we can conclude that these chips have been individually been developed. So some companies put in a lot of effort and time to develop their own STM32F1 equivalent chips. So please note that all the GD32 devices here have a second die in their package. That is something I haven't seen before in microcontrollers. However, we will come back to that later on. The security concept of the STM32F1 is quite simple. So you have 2 flash readout protection levels. So the chip comes in RDP level 0, where you have full access. Then you upload your code to the chip and you lock it into RDP level 1. And then flash memory cannot be read out via the debugger anymore. The GD32F130 has RDP level 2, and that entirely disables the debug interface. The debug configuration and security settings are stored in the flash memory, so if you write 33CC into that specific location, you get into RDP level 2. If you write A55A into that memory location, you get RDP level 0, and everything else maps onto RDP level 1. The security concept is centered around flash memory confidentiality. Whoever uses the chip may store some valuable firmware in the flash memory, which should never be read out by a competitor. But flash memory could also contain some private data from a user, for example some private keys or other data you don't want to get into the wrong hands. On this slide you can see a basic diagram of the internal workings of the chip. Technically, only a bus master can access the flash memory, So that's the debug module, the CPA, and the DMA. So even if the chip is secure, the DMA module and the CPU both need to have access to the flash memory, simply to execute the firmware. However, an attacker must never have access to the flash memory, and access must be prevented. This is so far correctly implemented in all the chips that we have analyzed. However, what some developers tend to overlook is that there are also indirect ways to access flash memory. For example, one could try to tamper with the CPU or try to reconfigure the DMA module. So it is unclear whether something that we call indirect flash access will give us access to the data that is stored in the flash memory. So we will just try this out in some experiments. So first of all, we tested the GD32VF103, that's the RISC-V device here, and we noticed that using the debugger we are allowed to write code into the SRAM and to execute this code afterwards. What we also noticed then is that when we execute this code from SRAM, we are allowed to access the flash memory and read data from that. And that enables us to steal the data from the flash memory, despite the device is flash memory read protected. So, also for the CKS32F1, it's quite similar. It reminds me a little bit of return-oriented programming, because we noticed that you can single step through your flash memory here, and you can execute arbitrary instructions with arbitrary parameters. So what we do here is we find ourselves a load instruction and modify the CPU registers in such a way that we read from flash memory, and thereby we can just dump the entire flash memory using something that we call load instruction gadget stepping. I will just show you how this works in practice. Initially, we connect our device under test to the debugger. Then we start our debugging software to attach to the device. Next, we will verify that we indeed cannot read from flash memory. As you can see here, nothing is returned, so flash reader protection is active. Now we will mount our attack by launching the script. This script searches for a load instruction and repeatedly executes it to extract the flash memory contents. You can see those contents being output on the right hand side. On the left hand side, you see the program counter PC, that's the gadget that we are currently using, and you see R1, and that is the address of the flash memory that is currently being extracted. As you can see here, the attack works quite well and can extract large amounts of data within a few minutes. During our experimentation, we noticed that we can trigger interrupts using the debugger. Each time an interrupt is triggered, the address of the corresponding interrupt service routine is fetched from the vector table in flash memory. This process is observable, so this leaks the interrupt vector table contents from the flash memory. However, that is not considered as problematic, as this data is not really confidential. However, then we noticed that we can change the pointer that points to the interrupt vector table in flash memory. And by moving that, for example, into the code space and triggering interrupts, we are now able to extract all the other data from the flash memory so far. All in all, we reach about 90% coverage for the flash memory. However, 10% remain inaccessible since not all interrupts are available for this processor. That is marked in red in the figure on the right-hand side here. For the GD32F103, we found a way to redirect the control flow. For that, we first write a firmware into the SRAM using the debugger. Then, we relocate the interrupt vector table from the flash memory into our firmware in SRAM and trigger an interrupt, though the control flow gets diverted from flash memory into our own firmware in SRAM. However, this does not trigger any security mechanisms, because these steps can be done without enabling the low-level debug module inside the CPU, and thus also read access to flash memory remains active. And using this approach, we can dump the entire flash memory within just a few seconds. However, there are even more attacks that affect the same chip as well as the CKS32. We noticed that we have access to the DMA using the debugger. and we can just reconfigure the DMA while the device is running. When we configure the DMA, we instruct it to copy the data we want to read out from flash memory and just write it into the SRAM. Because as soon as the data is in SRAM, we can just read it out using the debugger since we have full SRAM access. And via that way, we can read out the entire flash memory again within a few seconds. However, this does not change much as we have found other vulnerabilities that affect both devices as well. So now we have even two vulnerabilities for those devices. So let's now come to some hardware-based attack vectors. So for the GD32F1 series, we noticed that they have two dies inside their package. So we investigated this further and noticed that there is a flash die atop of the logic die, and both dies are interconnected using some bonding wires. So we had the idea, let's just remove the top of the casing and access those bonding wires to get to the firmware. What sounds quite simple takes about several hours of careful sanding of the package, and then we gain access to the bonding wires. However, contacting them was very difficult because they are only a few micrometers thin, so I had to add some conductive silver paint to get a larger contact surface. But also after these steps, we were not able to eavesdrop the firmware yet because we noticed that the addresses and also the bits were obfuscated. This was, for example, not a linear address space, so the addresses were somewhat scrambled, and also the bits inside each byte, they were also permutated. However, I found a method to invert this obfuscation, and thereby we were able to gain access to the entire firmware that is stored and transported over that interconnect so far. However, I don't really consider this being a do-it-yourself attack anymore, because this is quite difficult and you may have trouble doing that at home. So since we are now able to eavesdrop data on the internal bus, we should also be able to manipulate data that is being transferred on that bus. So we tried this out for the GD32F130 to downgrade it from RDP level 2 to RDP level 0. So when I analyzed the communication, I noticed that the RDP setting 33CC, which corresponds to RDP level 2, is loaded from hex 4000. After I further analyzed the remaining communication, I also noticed that during boot up, the chip fetches some data from hex 400, and this data always starts with A55A. And if we remember this correctly from the beginning, then this value corresponds to RDP level 0. We don't really know why this constant is there, but we can use it for our purpose to break the security of this chip. So the idea was that we don't change the RDP level transmission itself, but we just change the address where the RDP level is loaded from. So therefore, we wait for the address phase of the RDP level loading on the bus and just override it with hex 400. And that redirects us our fetch to the value A55A. The microcontroller loads this value, and that causes it to fall back to RDP level 0, and all the flash memory is immediately readable via the debugger, for example. So if you now wonder how we can just hit this right moment in time, just have a look at this data, and especially at the yellow region here. This yellow region is a very typical pattern that always precedes the address phase of the RDP level loading. And this pattern is our trigger, and we can just see when the address phase happens and then override this data. So this one, this attack here, works very, very reliable, and we tried it out multiple times, and each time we were able to downgrade the security level to RDP level 0. So let's now come to our last hardware-based attack vector. During our experimentation with the APM32 and STM32 microcontrollers, we noticed that attaching a debugger to the device prevents most flash access and execution, as it is intended. So for this attack, we use a two-stage shellcode that we load into SRAM using the debugger. Afterwards, we trigger a power glitch. This power glitch is a very short interruption of the power supply for about 100 microseconds. This triggers a reset of the system, and the system forgets that a debugger has been connected before. However, since this glitch is so short, the shellcode in SRAM remains there. At next, we start the shellcode that is in SRAM. This is just the stage 1, and this code cannot read from the flash memory. However, it is allowed to add a hardware patch point to the beginning of the flash memory. And then we reset the system again and boot from flash, and this patch point gets triggered and control flow gets diverted back into our stage 2 shellcode in SRAM. And this stage 2 shellcode is a flash reader that just dumps us all our memory that we want to have. So this sounds very complex, and however, we were able to automatize a large portion of the setup here that I will now show you that this is indeed very simple and possible. Initially, we power up our experiment setup. Next, we start the debugging software to attach to our device under test. Now, we upload the two-stage shellcode into the SRAM of our device under test. Afterwards, we disconnect the debugger. Next, we start up a terminal that is connected to the serial interface of the device under test. As soon as I press the blue button, the glitch is triggered and the shellcode starts executing. We can communicate with it and order it to dump all flash memory. As you can see, the entire flash memory can be dumped within a few minutes. Thus, this complex approach can be highly automatized and quickly executed. Our results have shown that there is no exploit to rule them all. They are all individually developed devices with their own vulnerabilities. However, each device has at least one severe vulnerability that allows an attacker to extract the entire flash memory using only do-it-yourself methods. We attribute this to an insufficient security engineering on the manufacturer's side, since a lot of vulnerabilities are quite trivial and would have been detected in a serious design review. We tried to share our results with the manufacturers. However, this was unsuccessful so far for most of them, and only one manufacturer, GigaDevice, was responding to our emails. However, that is quite bad, because the weakness lies only in hardware and there are no software workarounds known to us. So that means that you have to rely on your manufacturer to provide a fixed hardware revision of the devices so that you are able to build secure devices with those chips again. So if you are further interested in this topic and want to try out the proof of concepts on your own, we publish all proof of concepts as well as their code online on the link you can see here. And if you have any further questions, do not hesitate to drop us an email. Thank you.